This video is brought to you by Envato. Matte painting, what is it? You'll usually hear it used when discussing films, especially with sci-fi and fantasy movies. However, the term matte painting has become a lot more broad in the last decade or two, so let's examine what matte painting actually is. I'm Abby Sparza with Envato Tuts Plus, and I have 10 years of experience in creative compositing. However, creative compositing and matte painting serve two very different purposes, but share the same technique of photo bashing, sometimes also referred to as photo manipulation. But first, let's go back to the days before Photoshop, because matte painting has been around for over 100 years. So originally, matte painting was a hyper-realistic backdrop used in photography and film. This technique allowed filmmakers to create really detailed environments of cityscapes and landscapes using various methods. Sometimes the actual mats, the paintings, were done by painting directly onto glass and then placing that glass in front of the camera. Sometimes they were used as actual backdrops on sets, often to extend the set or landscape or create otherwise impossible landscapes. As long as the subject stayed within the non-painted areas, it produced a very convincing effect. So these backdrops and paintings were meant to be hyper-realistic and blend seamlessly with the real-life actors and sets, making them just masterpieces in and of themselves. There are not many fantasy or sci-fi movies that exist without matte paintings, not a lot of good ones at least. In modern times, matte paintings serve the same purpose, but tend to be digital and a mixture of 3D, CGI, animation, photo elements, and hand painting. This introduced a newer technique called photo bashing or photo manipulation, often done in Photoshop, which uses both traditional painting techniques and photographed textures for added realism. And with the rise of Photoshop, so did the popularity of creating matte paintings for concept and digital art, not just films, sometimes just for fun. Which we'll be covering today, as I've picked up some photo compositing tips from watching matte painters that I find very useful. Starting with planning out your matte painting. By the way, this video is brought to you by Envato Elements, the largest unlimited creative subscription in the world. Get seriously creative. Click the link in the description to learn more. So when planning your matte painting, you'll likely want to start with some kind of sketch. You don't have to, but it's recommended. It doesn't have to be pretty or good. It's only there to act as a guide, mainly as a guide for composition and values. When creating the sketch, you should zoom your canvas out so it's nice and small, or make sure your navigator is turned on by going to Window, Navigator. Because your sketch is meant to guide the general shapes, composition, and values of your matte painting, not the details, you don't want to overly focus on any details. These can just be scribbles. Next, let's talk about the actual guides. There are a number of different guides you can use to help influence and build your composition. Personally, because I am simple, I like splitting my landscapes into thirds. We can do this very quickly by going to View, Guide, New Guide Layout, selecting the center option in the preset dropdown here. And now we're going to change the 2 in column and row to 3, and your canvas will be split into 3 sections. And then we can always toggle our guides on and off using Control/Command:\. If your scene also has a specific horizon line, mine really doesn't, adding a guide marking it will also be super helpful. So our rough sketch and guides are set up, let's discuss images. You should try and collect as many high resolution textures as possible, like an absolute load. There may be a lot of trial and error, so having a big pile of trees, stones, mountains, and skies, whatever you might need, ready will make your life a lot easier. You want to ensure they are high quality and have the correct license to use them. A big mistake beginners tend to make is just grabbing things straight from Google. You want to get your images and textures from legitimate sources, like Envato Elements, or by shooting and collecting them yourself. And this is going to bring us to 3D assets. 3D sculpting is a critical skill in matte painting, eventually. If you want to pursue matte painting, you'll definitely want to look into tools like Blender or Cinema 4D, or there are others as well. However, you can also use stock assets like these from Envato Elements. The key to a good 3D asset is being able to turn and angle those assets, downloading them at the correct angle we need. I'll be using the ship and a bunch of these clouds. I'm downloading all of them as PNGs as I don't need to worry about shadows. So we have our 3D assets and a bunch of photos. I went ahead and layered some already. This is not a full tutorial, but we definitely need to talk about extracting the textures. For the initial extractions, you'll most commonly use the lasso tool, the quick selection tool, and my personal favorite, what we'll be using right now, the object selection tool. There are other methods as well, like using channels to create selections, but making fast, rough selections are going to be what you want to do most of the time. So let's select a portion of this rocky cliff using the object select tool and add a layer mask. Now we want to go into select a mask, which can be found in the upper options bar right here. And we want to turn smart radius on and increase the radius until the edges of our rocky texture looks more rocky. If we really need to, we can further refine that mask using the global refinements. But keep in mind, the mask won't look perfect, because once it's looking fine, well enough, we can make any glass adjustments using a brush, ideally with a texture that kind of matches the surface of whatever you're masking. So for instance, it would be best to mask leaves and foliage with a leaf brush. I'm just using a messy edge brush for these rocks, just to be quick. And a little bonus tip, if you choose to use generative fill, I would not recommend using it to generate an actual object or image. Don't just generate mountains. Instead, though, you can use it to blend two sections of an image together. We can take the lasso tool and select an area that isn't blended or seems disconnected. Just a real quick sloppy selection. Now in the floating context bar, hit generate with no prompt, and Photoshop will try and blend the area together, kind of making it seem more natural. It's a slot machine though, you may have to regenerate several times, but it is an option you can always give a try if you want to. Now we can't talk about matte painting without talking about values. Values are how light or dark something is, regardless of hue. I've already added some haze and clouds, but we need to adjust their values and those of the rocks as well. Let's create what I call a value check layer. This layer will help us check our values while we paint and composite. Because remember, values are the lightness and darkness devoid of color. But let's create a new layer at the top of our layer stack and go to Edit, Fill, 50% Gray. And we're going to change its layer mode to color. And this will give us a black and white view of our image, which will help us see and adjust our values more easily without being distracted by the color. We can toggle it on and off as we go and lock the layer using this icon to keep us from accidentally selecting it. Highly recommended. Let's take a quick look at adjusting these values now. We want to make sure our value check layer is on, and let's create and clip a curves adjustment layer into this rock here. We want to bring down the right curve to darken it. And we're going to do the exact same thing to the stone behind it, but darkening it slightly less because it's further from the foreground. And for these mountains way off in the distance, we want to bring up the shadows. Not only are they more brightly lit, but they will be affected by atmospheric haze. You'll notice when something is very far away, it tends to appear lighter and have less contrast. That's caused by moisture, clouds, and all the gases in the air. So the further something is, the lighter it tends to be. Understanding atmospheric haze is a massive part of a successful matte painting, values in general. And it is much more complex than just a flat curves layer like I'm doing here, but both atmospheric haze and values in general are two topics you'll want to dive deep into if you're interested in matte painting. And that brings me to Envato Elements. Everything being in one place is key for matte painting. You want a fat, juicy library of textures. I love browsing Envato Elements and looking for interesting 3D assets and textures. Variety and versatility are essential to me in creative compositing and matte painting. I get very bored very quickly. So Envato Elements' almost endless sea of resources and assets provides me with an equally infinite sea of inspiration. I download a bunch at once so I can flow without interruptions. As always, you can use the link below to grab all the assets we are using here today or completely different ones, all from Envato Elements. So we've touched on the what and some basics. it'd be great to end with a couple easy, simple SFX type stuff that you can add to your concepts. First, let's focus on our ship's light trail here, because I think it's pretty cool. I love a light trail because it adds instant movement and a bit of dynamics. First, we need to grab an image of some light trails. I like using long exposure shots from highways. This one is perfect. Place the image on the canvas and set it to screen. Now we can use the transform tool to shape and warp the lights so they appear coming from the back of our ship. Let's add some blur using filter blur gallery path blur. And we're going to click to create and shape some paths, adding movement along the streams of light. And let's set the speed to around 80%, pretty high. Finish the light trails off by going to Image Adjustments Curves, bringing down the image's shadows, and this will remove any excess background from the lights. If you need to clean them up even further, add a layer mask and use a soft round brush set to black to remove any unwanted areas as well as darken some of those areas. And repeat the steps or duplicate the lights for doubling up on light trails or intensifying the effect. Finally, let's add some dots of light to the back of our ship as an actual light source. I like using layers set to screen, overlay, and color dodge, and just a default round brush, nothing fancy. Now we could use the motion blur filter to add some motion blur to our ship. However, I much prefer to use path blur for motion blur, just like we did with our lights. So let's select the ship and make sure it's a right-click smart object. This is important as we'll be using a smart filter mask. Let's go to Filter, Blur Gallery, Path Blur, again, placing and bending the paths to match the shape of our ship this time. And we want to set the speed to around 20%, nothing crazy. Next, let's grab a default round brush and click on the Smart Filter Mask, which is this mask here. We want to mask away the middle of our ship and any area where we don't want to have that path blur. I like to focus the movement effect on the wings and the bottom of the ship. And this is looking good enough. Matte painting is an incredibly impressive art form that requires proficient knowledge in multiple mediums and techniques. And even if we talked a lot about photo bashing in Photoshop today, you don't need to use textures and photos in matte paintings. They can be completely hand painted. They used to just be these incredibly impressive, highly detailed paintings painted by hand. I adore matte paintings from the 80s. Now they incorporate almost every creative technical skill though that you can think of alongside those traditional methods still. So was there a chance a humble creative compositor would cover it all in 13 minutes? No, not even slightly. But you can learn so much from matte painting as an art form that I think everyone should know more about, whether you're a photographer, a digital painter, whatever. If you liked this video, consider liking it and even subscribing if you still need to. And remember to click the bell icon to be notified of all new tutorials. A happy designing. See you next time, guys.